to the truth. From darkness, lead me to light. From death, lead me to immortality. Om, peace, peace, peace. Welcome all. Today we commence the auspicious Bhagavad Gita. The Bhagavad Gita literally translates to the song of God, the song of the divine, the song of the words that can ultimately liberate one's soul from the cycle of karma, which seems to be the ultimate destination that all the scriptures talk about, but intermittently can give us a lot of pointers of how to live a more peaceful, selfless life. The goal of a typical common person is not liberation. The goal of typical common person is to live happy, peaceful. My yoke is light. Is liberation in terms of living in the world. The final liberation, as we call it, moksha, is theoretical because our minds are flooded with other things at the moment. So making the mind light, performing action, duty, when it needs to be done, how it needs to be done, whether we like it or not, objectively, is itself liberating in terms of being effective in the world. The Gita is testimony to that. So today we start the Bhagavad Gita, which is interestingly a rendition through the voice of Sanjaya, talking to the king Dhritarashtra, telling him what's happening in the famous battlefield of Kurukshetra. Bhagavad Gita, as you all know, very well know, probably even better than me, is part of the epic Mahabharata. Mahabharata is supposedly one of the longest texts stories in the world, itihas. It is twice as long as the next two famous books in world literature combined. So it has that coveted title. So don't attempt to start reading it. It's going to take a lifetime. But the Gita comes towards the second half of the Mahabharata, when the two opposing forces, the Pandavas and the Kauravas, decide to engage in war. The holy war. So the first starting of Mahabharata starts with Dharma Kshetre Kurukshetre. So we will just read the Sanskrit sloka of the first sloka of Bhagavad Gita, and then we'll proceed to talk about it. Dharma Kshetre Kurukshetre Samaveta Yuyutsavaha Mamaka Pandavas Chaiva Kim Akurvata Sanjaya. So the Bhagavad Gita starts with Dharma Kshetre, Dharma, the holy land. Kshetra means field. The holy land, what? Kurukshetre. Kurukshetre is the field of the Kurus, the battlefield. So it's interesting, it starts with Dharma, but it's a battlefield. So it's a holy battle. So as all religion professes, one way to see the context of the Bhagavad Gita is a battle happening inside as much as a battle happening outside. Because all characters that we're going to see today, chapter one is a light chapter, but it's a very enchanting chapter because it introduces us not just to the outer characters, the six-pack warriors, as we can see these days, these people depicted, but also the inner temperaments and the inner status of these characters at the beginning of the war. Therefore, it's a holy war, meaning an attempt to purify oneself, so attempt to ask, what is my duty? The attempt to ask questions at moments of dilemma, because not always is our life a choice between good versus bad. Almost 90% of us, if the choice of good and bad is presented to us, we may choose good over bad. Do you want to steal money or do you not want to steal money? Most of us would say, I want to live virtuously. I don't want to steal money. But then life is a little more complicated and nuanced than that. Sitting in an armchair, looking at the world, our intellect can apply and we can say, that guy should do this. This guy should do this. This guy shouldn't go to war. That guy shouldn't do this. But when we are thrown in a moment of dilemma ourselves, The choices are not as low resolution as choosing from good versus bad. We see it in our own daily lives. What do I choose amidst two good options or amidst two bad options? Mostly our choices are choosing amidst two bad options. It's like that famous example, if a child is dying and that person doesn't have money to buy medicine, is it okay to rob a pharmacy shop to get that medicine to save the child? Legally, it's a theft. Morally, this person may feel happy that he saved a child. What is right? We don't know. Dharma is subtle. Guru Charan Das in his book, The Difficulty of Being Good, says dharma is subtle. What is dharma? We can't define. How do we know? It is the personal reality of the person acting. What is dharma? He finally concludes, Guru Charan Das. Dharma is the natural inclination of a good person's heart. How else can we define it in this case of this pharmacy example? Or the famous trolley problem in psychology, which is used and abused. All of you know the trolley problem, right? You see a trolley or a train steaming in, and you see a child there in the tracks ahead. You have a choice to either let the train go on and kill this child, or you have a choice to use the lever to change the direction of the train. And on that other side, there is one innocent child. On this track, if you leave the train going, there are five children, but on that side, there is one child. Now the choice is bad versus bad. You can choose inaction, saying, if I don't do anything, at least I'm saved of the choice. You can choose action, but then you're sacrificing one child who was not on that track at the cost of five children. So is five lives better saving than one child? You can't say. Who knows? Dharma is subtle. This trolley problem is not my example. This trolley problem is a famous psychology example. And there are many versions to it. So the Gita needs to be understood in context. Because on the first reading, it seems like, why are these brutal people going to war? Millions of people are going to die in this war. But the choice is bad versus bad. Now, how do we act out in those situations? Our own choices in life are not always a simple good versus bad choice. Therefore, the Gita is very relevant in understanding both the outer choices that we make and our inner temperament and the state of mind that we bring into those choices. So, Dharma Kshetre Kurukshetre, the holy field of the battlefield. What an oxymoron to start the Gita. Let's first introduce ourselves to certain characters. So you find that on this picture here, these are all characters introduced in chapter 1 of the Gita. As I said, everybody is depicted with six packs these days. We don't know their physical condition, but they're all great warriors. We know that. And if you know any context of the Gita, you would know there are two armies, the Kaurava army and the Pandava army. They are cousins who don't get along. But the Gita starts with the two characters on the far left here. Sanjaya, who's with King Dhritarashtra. Dhritarashtra is blind. Though he's the king, he can't fight. He's blind. And Dhritarashtra is a very interesting character. Dhritarashtra is an interesting character because is he good? Is he bad? You can't compartmentalize anybody in Mahabharata. And he is also one such complex character. Dhritarashtra, as Vyasa describes him, is a complex character. He's a weak character. He's like one of those leaders that you might have worked with who lacks conviction and courage, though otherwise they are a nice person. Dhritarashtra fully understands that the Pandavas are on the righteous side. He fully understands that his son, Duryodhana, who is the Kaurava prince, is on the wrong side. he understands that it's all because of the envy of his son against the Pandavas, that millions of people are dying. But he's too afraid to do anything about it. He's too afraid to intervene as a king. And in his heart, he harbors the same envy as Duryodhana harbors. It is a very interesting distinction. So as a king, he doesn't know what to do and he resorts to inaction. There are two kinds of envy. In our own hearts, they exist sometimes. What we call open envy and closed envy. Duryodhana is an example of open envy. He's an example of somebody who's envious and he makes everybody know that he's envious. He converts envy into destructive action. Dhritarashtra, his father, is an example of closed envy. Closed envy is he harbors the same feelings inside, but lacks the courage and conviction to express it. Therefore, dwells in his own mind. Who is worse? Probably closed envy is worse sometimes, is better sometimes. At least it always doesn't manifest into destruction outside. But internally, the suffering is the same. The karma that accrues is the same personally. So Dhritarashtra is an example of that weak leader. And at the very first beginning of the Bhagavad Gita, we realize the cost of having a weak leader who can't take a stance. Inaction doesn't always mean spiritual edification. Inaction doesn't always mean detachment. Inaction doesn't always mean I don't mind what happens, so I'm not going to interfere in a situation knowing that I can act better in the situation. Inaction is a disease. Inaction can lead to harm. So Dhritarashtra at the very beginning is sitting comfortably in his chamber asking Sanjaya, the next character we're going to see, is a person who has a divine vision of seeing the battleground and what's happening there from the chambers of Dhritarashtra. And he's articulating to the king Dhritarashtra, because Dhritarashtra does not have eyesight himself. He's articulating to the king everything happening in the battlefield. Now, Sanjaya is an interesting character. Sanjaya is not a warrior, but Sanjaya, in his heart, is more pitiful to the side of the righteous. So you find even in chapter 1 and throughout, Sanjaya understands fully well where the right is. The right is in the side of Pandavas. So in fact, Sanjaya's hope in his heart is, can the king intervene at least now? Can I describe the situation in a way, at least now the king feels that enough is enough. I don't want millions of people to die. Can I intervene as a king? But Dhritarashtra is afraid of his own son. That is actually the definition of Kali Yuga. Though that wasn't Kali Yuga, but you can see that example. My grandfather used to say, Kali Yuga is where the parents are afraid of children. Not the children are afraid of parents. Nobody should be afraid of anybody in reality. Children being afraid of parents is not the word afraid. It's modesty or it's respect. But parents being afraid of children, unable to intervene, my grandfather would say jovially, is the definition of Kali Yuga. And here in Mahabharata, you can already see that. The father terrified of his son, his son's rage, and also having a biased blind spot, blind love for his son. Look at that combination of a weak king. One, terrified of his son's anger. And number two, having a soft spot for his son. Very well knowing that that soft spot will lead to his own son's demise in the end. That's the complex character of Dhritarashtra. So when we think of Dhritarashtra, we should ask ourselves, where do we become Dhritarashtra? Do we have closed envy that is disguised as virtue in the world? It's easy to spot Duryodhanas in the world. It's very difficult to spot Dhritarashtras in the world. They appear innocent, timid. They appear spiritually detached. But internally, the same Dharma Kshetri, Kurukshetri, the internal war is happening inside them as well. Sanjaya is an interesting character who doesn't have a vested interest, but who understands as he sees the battlefield in his divine vision that he hopes his rendition of what's happening may change the king's mind. But alas, people are vain. Nobody changes in a skeptical way. Dhritarashtra, every moment of narration feels, I hope this stops. I hope my son changes. But he doesn't want to intervene because he's too afraid. And in the deepest recess of his heart, he wants his son to win, even if it's an adharmic battle. Those are the first two characters. Once that begins, Sanjaya starts narrating. He looks at the battlefield where both the armies have assembled on either sides. Hundreds of thousands of people. Great leaders leading their troops, the Maharathas, each of them commanding a battalion of 11,000 people. So 11,000 multiplied into X on the Pandava side and the Kaurava side. Now Duryodhana, so the first character that Sanjaya starts speaking about is Duryodhana. Not Krishna, not Arjuna, Duryodhana. Duryodhana looks at the opposition and looks at his own army. Do you realize that when people are driven by emotions that are not objective, in this case, envy and pride and the possessive need to win, they are not focused on the outcome or the process. They end up speaking a lot unnecessarily and trying to convince people to come on their side, to be on their side, even though they are on their side on paper. So Duryodhana starts speaking to Dronacharya. Drona is their martial arts guru, isn't it? Guru of both the Pandava side and Kaurava side, because they were cousins. So they grew up together under the same teacher, same guru, Dronacharya. Dronacharya was born a Brahmin, not a Kshatriya, but he was one of the greatest people on the battlefield. He is the one who taught both the sides how to fight, how to wield weapons. So he starts speaking to Dronacharya, comparing his army and the Pandavas' army. So in reality, the way the Kurukshetra battle is set up is that the Kaurava army is much larger than the Pandava army. All of this has a deeper connotation as well. We'll come to it, not over-exaggerated, but come to it when it's useful. The setting is based on pure numbers. The Kaurava's army outnumber the Pandava's army. But based on spirit and energy, the Pandava's army is much more high-spirited and energetic than Kaurava army. There is some merit being on the righteous side. The numbers may be small, but the spirit is always higher. And an example is shown in chapter 1 of the Gita itself, because when they blow the conches, when Bhishma, who is the commander-in-chief of the first commander-in-chief of the Kauravas army, when he blows the conches and everybody in the Kauravas side shout, it creates good noise. But when the Pandavas blow the conches and their army shouts the battle cry, it shudders the heavens and the earth, it's described. It creates noise that reaches the far side of the earth. It sends shivers in the bodies and minds of the enemy, it is described. So what through an analogy, Sanjaya is telling Dhritarashtra, is that Pandavas are lesser by number, greater by spirit. Kauravas are greater by number, but unsure by spirit. Because in the deepest parts of our heart, we know whether what we are doing is dharmic to our own selves or not. And lined up in the Kaurava side are all great people. Not all of them are triggered by envy. Bhishma, Drona, and scores of people who are otherwise wise men, who are otherwise led a dharmic life. They're caught between the devil and the deep blue sea, which is they understand that the other side is the righteous side, but they're also bound to duty to serve their side. It is an amazing character analysis. We'll see a little more in a minute. So these are the other characters introduced. And in detail, the first 10 sloka goes into who are the chieftains and commanders and lead soldiers on both the sides. The conch is blown. In fact, the conch is blown because Duryodhana starts speaking to Drona and Bhishma. And he goes all over the place because he's agitated. And Bhishma says, enough is enough, I'll blow the conch. At least let's start what we've come here to do. The conch is blown. So in history records, the first trigger of offense was initiated by Kauravas. It's also metaphorical because the war itself began because all options were exhausted for the side of Pandavas. They were exiled, as you know, for many years. When they came back, they demanded their share of the kingdom. It wasn't given. The negotiations happened. That didn't succeed. They asked for 5 towns. That didn't happen for the 5 Pandavas. 5 villages, no. Then Duryodhana said, I cannot give you even the space of a hairpin on the ground. And go, so on and so on. And later, if we have time, we will talk about, not today, but we will talk about what are the options one needs to negotiate? What are the options one needs to first go with before getting to the worst case scenario? Negotiations. Letting go. Threat. It degrades. It starts with coming together and have a virtuous conversation, to negotiation tactics, to threat tactics. When nothing works, you go to something as base as waging a war. So where I'm getting at is, this is a last case scenario and nobody is happy being there. The next character introduced, we've seen Sanjaya, Dhritarashtra, Duryodhana, the open envy, Dhritarashtra, the wise, the close envy. Bhishma is introduced as the great warrior, the first commander-in-chief of this war. After his death, you will find many other commander-in-chiefs of the Kaurava army. We are introduced to Bhima and a few other people in the Panchapandavas and their army as the great warriors on their side. And then finally, Sanjaya talks about Arjun. Arjun, our main hero and protagonist in this entire 18 chapters. Arjuna is a reflection of us. We'll come to why. And Krishna, who is his charioteer. Partha, Partha Sarathi. Partha is son of Prita, I guess, if I'm right. That is another name for Kunti. So Partha is Arjuna's name. And Krishna often refers to Arjuna as Partha. And Krishna is therefore Partha Sarathi because he is the charioteer of Partha. It's very interesting, Krishna's backstory in this war. Because Krishna, it's interesting because Krishna offers himself to both the sides because he is neutral to both the sides. He's not part of this family. So he, it seems, goes to Duryodhana and asks, do you want me on your side? Or I can give you my entire battalion. One side gets my troops, thousands and thousands of my soldiers, and the other side gets me. And Duryodhana says, he compares the numbers. When you are in a, when you are driven by your mind and envy, you're not able to see through what may save you. So he is focused on the battle, envy, he chooses the numbers. And then when he goes to the Pandavas, Krishna, the Pandava says, Krishna, if you are on our side, what else do we need? Why do we need the soldiers? It's you who being on our side is important. So that's how Krishna become. And but Krishna says, the condition is, I will not wield any weapon. Until the end of the war, Krishna, being the formidable warrior he himself is, does not engage in direct battle himself. It's not like the threat America is doing now. We will not fight directly. We will not fight directly, but we will send this, we will send that to Ukraine, right? So Krishna genuinely does not pick up a bow or arrow or sword in the Bhagavad Gita. But of what prestige it is to have the Lord himself as your charioteer. Blessed are those who have holy people, wise people around them. Even more blessed are those who have people of such caliber at our side when we need it the most. Even blessed are those who have a friendly relationship with that person. So Arjuna and Krishna are friends. And if you've attended the Gita classes before, 2 years ago, you would find that Krishna tells many times to Arjuna through the Gita. He says sometimes, Arjuna, you don't deserve this knowledge, but because you're my friend, let me tell you what it is. Because you're my friend, let me show you the Vishwarupa. Because you're my friend. So befriending God in the spirit that Arjuna did is itself a very beautiful thing. We can have many relationships with God. In our culture, God can be master, God can be friend, God can be seen as your better half, God can be seen as a child. So there are many examples where you may use words to God like you would do to a child. It's not disrespect. People all have their own personal relationship with the divine. So Arjuna's relationship with Krishna is that of a friend, equals. And that itself is a beautiful trajectory in Mahabharata. So these are the characters introduced. Now, I want to say why these characters are interesting. Nobody is exempt of a vice in the Mahabharata, unlike Ramayana, where Ram is this perfect character, isn't it? Everything good about the world is Ram. Ram is the person we all idolize, or people idolize, because in any situation, refer what he did or what his mindset is. And it is always the correct mindset. There is literally no vice, intentional vice in Ram. But Mahabharata is more complicated because the Yuga has changed, people have changed, and Kali Yuga, it's probably topsy-turvy, as they say it. It's easier to apprentice vice than virtue. Vice was the aberration in Ram's time. Virtue was the norm. Virtue is the aberration in our time. Vice is the norm, said a famous author. So when I was, it's interesting where Guru Charan Das, as going back to him, analyzed and what are the top emotion that you would attribute to each character. And I've just put it, his book is called Difficulty of Being Good. And it interestingly, he says everybody has an emotion that they find very difficult to leave. Vice or virtue, attachment to that is a bondage, that is a burden you need to carry. We're not going to go through these characters. We haven't come to most of these characters. But this is an interesting representation to show who's in the battlefield. Duryodhana, as we said, his emotion that ruined him is envy. Envy can be a very strong emotion, sir. And you find in chapter one, interestingly, Duryodhana's envy explained very well. Envy makes a person both mentally sick and physically sick. The mind-body connection is established both in Arjuna and Duryodhana. Arjuna, out of another emotion, we'll come to Arjuna's vice in a bit. Arjuna says in chapter one, in a while, we're not got there yet, that he feels physically sick. He's shivering, the sheen of sweat in his forehead. Duryodhana throughout the Mahabharata is pale in color, pale because of envy. Both physically and within your systems inside, your digestive system, your nervous system. Anxiety is what? Nervous attack. Digestion, your neurotransmitters, they all have a direct connection to the state of your mind. Aristotle said, a person may have the knowledge but not use it. That's an example of many characters in the Gita. Immanuel Kant says envy is inherent in the nature of man. So when we see Duryodhana, we got to ask ourselves, when do we manifest that? Why do we envy? What happens? There are two kinds of envy. One envy is healthy competition. I'm saying this because we don't want to think in absolutes when we study the Gita. If we don't envy, how the hell do we succeed in a capitalistic world that we are in? If we don't want to create the next Tesla, if we don't want to beat that person, if we don't want to become that CEO, if we don't want to, we need to have some ambition. And ambition is often driven by looking at others who have succeeded, isn't it? You need a benchmark and say, I will beat that benchmark. That is some kind of envy, isn't it? If he can achieve, I can achieve. But that's called healthy competition, where you're turning envy not as an emotion that the other person should fail, but as a good benchmark for you to achieve. So what is healthy competition? Wanting something without the other person needing to lose it. So when we have these bouts of emotions, it's useful to ask ourselves, what am I really feeling? When I see that other guy in office succeed, when I see that other girl making it in life, when I see somebody else having a lot of money, when I see somebody else having better relationships, when I see those Instagram posts where everybody seems to be having a jolly good life, what is it exactly I'm feeling? If we isolate that feeling and dive into it, therein lies insight for you. One kind of envy, which is actually not envy, which is ambition, is I want something without the other person needing to lose it. I also want to buy a car because it's convenient for me and my family. But when I watch my neighbor having a car, I'm using that as to imagine how nice it would be if I work hard and can afford a car, and I'm actualizing it in my own life. And after that, I go to my neighbor and say, thanks. I don't tell it probably, but I feel that, because without you, I wouldn't have got that ambition. That's healthy competition. You're achieving in your own life without wanting to see the other person fail. The other kind of envy is, as Gore Vidal says, American author, in another context, he says, when a friend succeeds, something in me dies. It's very interesting. When somebody else succeeds, something in me dies, he says. Let's not discard this as a villain's emotion. We know heart in heart, it happens to us sometimes. When you see another person succeed, something in me dies. Now that is the vice. That will haunt us to death. Now that leads to a direct physical effect. So why is Duryodhana's skin pale in color? Why is Duryodhana's physical manifestation of his mental condition established in detail in the Mahabharata? Is because his envy is of the latter kind. His envy is not a dopamine supply for him to succeed in life. His envy is wanting to see the other party fail, because when they succeed, something in me dies. If I go down, I'm taking everybody down with me. It's that. I don't mind everybody dying, but those people cannot sit in the throne. That's Duryodhana's feeling. I don't mind seeing the world burn as long as they don't succeed. Now that envy makes us perish. It is the beginning of the end of mental and physical agitation. It's the beginning of the end of happiness in our lives. We have seen, isn't it, in another context? All of us have ego. Ego means the sense of I. Even a self-realized person has an ego. But our ego is reinforced because of three things. A high sense of doership. A high sense of... What's the second thing? Doership?
Entitlement.
Correct. A high sense of entitlement. And third, a high sense of complex. Complex is a continuous comparison of myself with another person. Am I better? Am I worse? Am I better? Am I worse? If I look at Instagram, I feel bad. If the moment I win something, I feel great. That enhances the ego. And Duryodhana suffers from all three, but particularly the last one, the complex. When they win, something in me dies. Right? Duryodhana also has something called the special envy. Like Einstein's general theory of relativity and special theory of relativity for the physics lovers. There is a general envy and a special envy possible as well, right? If you look at the Holocaust, you can say that there was a general envy towards the Jews, because wherever the Jews went, they ended up succeeding from the last 3,000 years. Succeeding financially, they brought in prosperity, etc., whatever. So there's a general envy. It is not targeted to a particular Jew or a particular person. There's a general envy to a community, to a religion, to a set of people, to an ideology. And then there is special envy, special case of envy, where it is targeted solely to one person or one object. He has that woman. I need to attain her. You find examples in the Mahabharata itself, or in Duryodhana's case. I'm otherwise a good person, but when it comes to the Pandavas, I become a monster. Again, reflect our own lives. General envy is envy as a motherhood statement. It is cast upon a wide ideology, a wide group. But special envy makes an otherwise decent person into a monster. It's easy for us to look at a Hitler and the Germans and say that there was a general case of envy towards the Jews. And you would say, I can never be that. I can never be part of that party. You're right. the general envy seems more dirty in the face value, and it's very difficult for most of us to partake in such a general envy. The special envy is what that converts an otherwise decent person into the same monster that a Hitler could be, because you're targeting all your envy on a person, a situation, an object, those five people. And in Duryodhana's case, the special envy was against Pandavas. He was otherwise a generous person, isn't it? In fact, once you have a vice like envy, it is very difficult for you to say, even in your good times, whether the virtue is real virtue or a virtue is targeted, a virtue comes in because of that envy that's simmering beneath it. Because if you look at Duryodhan, what he did to Karna is the most generous thing he did in his life. He got a friend for life. Karna would later die for Duryodhana because of what Duryodhana did to him. But was that real friendship? Was it real generosity? Or was it again because of the envy of towards the Pandavas? When Karna was discarded as a fisher person's son, as a lower caste, though he is a Pandava himself, we all know that, but he was obviously raised by the fishermen and fisherman and fisherwoman. So when he was discarded as a lower caste person, Duryodhana says, I embrace him as my brother, as my friend. I give him land and property. I have raised his status. Now let him fight against Arjuna. It is an otherwise beautiful thing to do. But the problem when we are mind-driven, sir, is we don't know whether our external generosity, external charity, external virtue signaling stems from real virtue or stems from a deeper vice. We don't know. That's the problem with samsara. That's the problem with becoming mind-driven. The rich person, sir, has put his name in history books because he has built three temples. Charity, dana. Sir, but he has built all temples in his name. Internally, he wants his name to survive the test of immortality. What is virtue if you are not objective, if you are not driven by buddhi? Externally, you may be virtuous, sir, but internally, you don't feel that peace of mind. That doesn't mean you should not be externally virtuous. What Duryodhana did to Karna was a beautiful thing. And therefore, Karna is loyal unto death to Duryodhana. Building hospitals or schools are a beautiful thing. So external virtue can still be there. Your internal peace of mind has got literally nothing to do with external virtue. Meaning actions that benefit the society is beautiful for the society. Your state of mind only depends on the intentions that back that original action. State of mind in the long term. Of course, when you cut that ribbon, it's pleasurable. See, sir, if you did something good for the society, but if your intention was fame, then your pleasure and peace of mind is held hostage to whether what you wanted, you got it or not. If you didn't get the fame you thought you deserved, you still don't sleep well in the night, even though you've done something beautiful to the world. That's the problem with having strong held emotions and biases. Even though we think we are doing the right rituals, even though we think we are triggering the right karma, even though we think we pray for 4 hours a day, even though we think we have a mala and do japa, even though we think we go to 4 temples, even though we do all of that, why is there a void in our own hearts? Why is there a constant sense of incompletion? Why is there a constant sense of something is wrong, something is missing? That is because our intentions are always desire-oriented. Therefore, we have struck a bad negotiation with life. Too much external effort to too little internal gain. It's a bad negotiation if you've done MBA or negotiation classes. Best negotiation is where you give you less effort, more reward. That's the best bargain you can strike in negotiation. Most of our lives, 90% of us, generally good people, most of our life, bad negotiation. Do more, less reward internally. The audit needs to happen. Why do I continue to feel that incompletion, void, searching for something? The peace in my heart is like water in a pot with holes. Sometimes it's full, but often it drains. It's a leaky bucket. Why is it a leaky bucket? Because without our own conscious knowledge, our intentions have not been audited. Right? And that's the problem we find with envy, with greed, with pride, with attachment, possessiveness, entitlement. With doership, entitlement, and complex overlaid on ego and reinforced over time. Because today the society says you are entitled. Society says there's greater reward for somebody with greater doership. And there's complex everywhere. The overlay of that, you may do all the right things, sir, but you will be in a constant search of something that will make you happy someday, which is illusory. Let's go back to the Gita. That's where we are. It's a beautiful start to the Bhagavad Gita. So we saw here Drona, Duryodhana's envy. Guru Charandas says Draupadi's courage, Yudhishthira's duty, Arjuna's despair, despondency, that's chapter 1. Bhishma's selflessness, Krishna's guile, cunning intelligence, guile means, Ashwatthama's need for revenge, Yudhishthira's remorse. So the difficulty of being good, every chapter, it's not a chronological sequence of Mahabharata. It's a dissection of people's emotions. Anyway, so Duryodhana's envy is established in chapter 1. Next, we come to Arjuna's despair. Now, I want to take you through one thing. Last night, I was thinking of how does chapter 1 establish its characters and what does that mean for us? And I'm sharing my screen now. There are two axes that I thought beautifully existed. And they're all in the battlefield. Listen carefully. They're all in the battlefield. They're all engaged in the same action, right? But people are in different capacities in their mind. So if you divide this entire group of people, you can say, are you in the part of the righteous side or are you in the part of the unrighteous side? Say that's one division, right? And overall, if we say the Pandavas are in the side of the righteous side. The Kauravas are in this part of the unrighteous side. A fair division. Again, not nuanced enough, but fair division. Then the other axis is very interesting. Are you engaged in this war for personal reasons? Are you engaged in war as a duty for impersonal reasons? Now, let's see what emotions get triggered. Because people are in the same battle. If you look at the top left, and these examples are not cast in stone, we can debate forever, but I've just put a few names, that's not important. But to say where people are in this world. So being part of the righteous side, meaning in your heart, your yoke is light, even though you're doing a bad thing. Because you're true to yourself, knowing that you're in the righteous side. That is the y-axis. And the reason you're engaging in battle is not an ego trip, but because it is something that needs to be done in your role as a warrior, in your role as a kshatriya, in your role as a king. This is called the intellect riding the tide here. So typically, these are not quotations from the Gita, it's my words, but in your innermost heart, this is what you would be thinking. I'll do what needs to be done, having evaluated all options. That's Yudhishthira. I'll do what needs to be done, having evaluated all other better options. It's not about me. It's about doing the right thing. This war is not about me. I'm not killing anybody. I'm not saving anybody. I'm performing my duty because it needs to be done. Now, this is a privileged state to be. These people also engage in battle if that's what their duty is. These people also engage with the bright city lights if that's what their, well, that's where their work is. But if you are in the righteous side, what is the righteous side? To thine own self be true, as Shakespeare says. To thine own self be true. In a quiet moment, ask your own self, is there hypocrisy in my pursuit? If there is no hypocrisy in your pursuit, you're often on the righteous side. And what do I want out of this situation? Is it a personal gain or is it what needs to be done? These are two very interesting questions. So you find certain people in the battlefield are on this side. They are on the righteous side and they are engaged for impersonal reasons. So often the statements here will be how we define intellect. What is right action? Doing what needs to be done, when it needs to be done, whether I like it or not. Whether my personality tickles it or not. So that is being on the righteous side, path of Shreyas, as well as being engaged for objective reasons, not for personal reasons. Then there is an entire set in this battlefield who are in this bottom left, which is they are as much engaged for objective reasons, for impersonal reasons, but unfortunately find themselves in the unrighteous side. Interesting, isn't it? I am duty bound to this side as I have sworn allegiance. I'm too deep in the rabbit hole now to get out of it. I know what I'm doing is wrong, but there's little I can do now. Or I myself don't have a bone to pick here, but the person I'm doing it for is too close to me. Can you think of more examples in our world that may fit that side? I myself am not corrupt. I will never take bribe, but I'm part of Wall Street. I'm just joking. The 2008 financial crisis, filled with good people, but a corrupt system. How is that possible? It doesn't mean we have to change our jobs. I'm just saying what it means. We know that when we watch the news, we need to protect the climate. But we are the ones who want that 4 vacations a year because we have suddenly found money in life. Why should I be deplete of those experiences? But at the same time, I want these people to do this. Examples, right? I know my company I know that my organization, in general terms, I know my organization through its supply chain. There's a lot to be answered for. But I have a family and EMIs, and I'm too deep into this profession that I can't get out of it. So let me at least do my work okay. To thine own self be true. We do live in that cognitive dissonance at times. So people in that category live in cognitive dissonance. On one side, they are bound to express themselves because their organization has given them an opportunity and good money. On the other side, there's something that creates conflict in their own hearts. Because, you know, overall, this is not good for the overall society. Happens, right? Many examples that you can share here. So examples here are like the Dronacharyas of the world, the Bhishma, even Karna. Karna is bound to his friendship. He's not engaged to any personal vendetta, but he's bound to his friendship to Duryodhan. So he ends up being part of the unrighteous side. Bhishma, Dronacharya, bound to their duties to that dynasty, to that kingdom. They find themselves in unrighteous side. We're not judging anybody here, remember? We are all of this. We are in all four buckets. But the difference between being objective, being engaged for impersonal reasons, yet the difference being in the righteous and unrighteous side is what happens inside of you. There is a moral hypocrisy in the bottom. There is lightness on top. There is some kind of self-deception in the bottom. There is transparency and peace of mind, even in the most trying situations at top. What about the other boxes on the right? On the right side, on top, people who find themselves in the righteous side, but engaging in the activity for personal reasons, personalizing the situation. This could be things like, I'm avenging a wrong. I'm here to give it back. It creates natural resentment, sir. And that's a load you have to carry. For example, if somebody wrongs you, and as an objective person, you can't be a doormat, so you need to take action legally, whatever. You can ask yourself, where in this four-box matrix do you sit? If you are in the righteous side, meaning you know that you're not exploiting that guy, you are in the side legally and morally, you're on the right side. You're being exploited. You're fighting the right fight. But you're doing it impersonally, meaning you're not carrying hate or resentment in your heart. But rather you're asking yourself, what is the right thing to do in this situation? What should a person who's got exploited do in this situation? Because also of my social duty of ensuring that I'm not doing inaction and multiplying this kind of behavior to other people as well. That's why we put thieves behind bars. Not because of personal hatred, but because to create social order, some kind of social order. You need to quarantine certain elements of the society, not because you hate them, but because 8 billion people need to live in some order. Otherwise, it can descend to barbarianism. So if you're on the top left, you're going to think about what needs to be done, when it needs to be done, whether I like it or not. If you're on the top right, you are still fighting that righteous fight, but you're doing it for egocentric reasons, including I need justice, including This is an opportunity to avenge a wrong. This is an opportunity to give back, give it back. Or in Arjuna's case, starting as, I am a hero, the most skillful warrior, and I'm here to save the world. Winning is very important. Or in Arjuna's case again, or in many other cases here, I like, because I'm here for some personal desire, personal ego, I like the nice bits, but I dislike the bitter bits. Which is, I want to win the war, but I don't want to be the person who kills my relatives on the other side. These are all complex mental conditions, sir. I want to win, but I don't want to do the dirty work. I want to be in that investment bank, but don't tell me the truth about it. Then I will feel bad. You know, so it's personal. Just because you don't want to feel bad, we kind of deceive ourselves into not seeing the things we don't want to see and seeing the things we want to see. And in Arjuna's case, he wants success as much as anybody else, as much as Duryodhana. Arjuna wants success as well. That's why he's there. That's why he's dressed up. That's why he's in the battlefield. But at the moment of crisis that we are going to see now, he then realizes that success which he knows is right, that success which he knows is the path of righteousness, requires, it's not going to come in a platter. It requires work. That work is something that his ego doesn't allow him to do, which is Krishna calls out as virtue signaling. Nothing right or wrong here. We're just looking at asking ourselves, just because you're in the righteous side, what is triggering action? Today, all religions or ideologies think they are on the righteous side. But if you ask deeper, are you engaged for personal reasons? Meaning, are you engaged for your inadequacies, you to feel good? Or are you engaged for objective reasons, sir? Most people are on the top right. Sorry, I was managing something. And the final box here. It's technically the worst place to be in. But Mahabharata is not about judging anybody or anybody. It's evaluating and learning. So part of the unrighteous side, meaning I know there is moral hypocrisy of doing what I'm doing. Unrighteous side doesn't mean easily categorizing people into good and bad sides. It means that in my deepest part of the heart, I know one and one is not adding up. I know I should not be doing this. That is the unrighteous side. To my own self, I am not being true. In the larger scheme of things, I know it is my envy or pride that has led me here. I could have easily given them 5 villages and everything would have been sorted. But as much as I know, I still don't want to. That's the unrighteous side we're talking about. But what makes it worse and amplifies that is being on the unrighteous side, not because you're tied to it, like the left side here, but you're there for personal reasons, egocentric trip, like the envy that we talked about. So in Duryodhana's case, I envy them. I cannot let them win. I will take the world down with me, but I cannot let that person win. I can't discriminate between right or wrong anymore. Famous line again. I can't discriminate between right or wrong anymore. My mind is too full with things that I'm too filled with envy that I don't know what is right or wrong anymore. this envy or hate is too gratifying to let go. It's not that I don't know that there is a better way of living. It's not that I don't know forgiveness is important. It's not that I don't know that letting go of this resentment will help my own self. But this hate or envy is too gratifying to me. This has started feeding me. Letting go of this hate feels like letting go of the only thing that makes me feel happy is hating that person. It's not too difficult to understand. Or you may have a bad habit, for example, which is otherwise bad for your health. It could be sugar, it could be cigarettes, it could be whatever it is, right? Which is otherwise killing you. Coca-Cola, whatever it is, which is otherwise killing you, or, you know, alcoholism. But why is it everybody who has an iota of brain is not going to argue that it is actually vitamins and minerals that's helping? They all know it's harmful for health. Why is it difficult leaving it? Because of the short-term pleasure, because of your own mental reinforcements, far outweighs the long-term gain, because we're always suckers for what's immediate. For 5 minutes of pleasure, our mind is capable of screwing 50 years of happiness. In Duryodhana's case, which is mental, not like a cigarette or a sugar or Coca-Cola, that envy itself is so gratifying that he doesn't know if he leaves envy and embraces virtue, it feels too uncomfortable and alien for him, because this is what is feeding him now. Anger, when we are angry, we obviously repent the next day. Sometimes when you shout at your loved one or get into an argument unnecessarily, how many times have you felt the last 2 hours, unnecessarily I was raising my voice and debating a topic that I don't bloody care, she or he doesn't bloody care. We both are just spectators to this phenomenon. Is this a good prime minister or not? Is that person good or not? These kind of arguments, right? The couch chair arguments. Get into 2 hours of heated debate, and often you feel miserable at the end of it, saying, I wasted my time, I wasted your time. Unnecessarily, we got into this debate. None of us benefits. We're all going to pay our taxes at the end. So why the hell talk about this? But at that moment, it's not a different person. You're still the same person with the same brain and same intellect. But what happens? That momentary need to give it back, that punchline to prove a point, that is much more gratifying than pausing, saying a sorry, and moving on. It's much more gratifying, sir. It's true for you, true for me, true for all of us. Lust works that way. Greed works that way. Anger works that way. Wrath. Pride works that way. Envy works that way. That's why it's the deadly sins. Why? The deadly sins are the greatest addictive substances. Gluttony, greed, wrath, pride, lust, envy, sloth, kama, krodha, lobha, moha, madad, mamchari. These are the most addictive substances, more addictive than sugar, more addictive than LSD, more addictive than any drug. Because the immediate gratification is 100%, not 80, not 60. We often become accountable only to our immediate self without being accountable to our future self. That's the short-term perspective. Therefore, we can't judge people on this bottom right. We are there ourselves at times. But anyway, I put this graph together to show you that you may find 1,000 people doing the same thing externally. They're all on the battlefield ready to fight. But you find that people are in very different dimensions internally. Are you getting it? That's the beauty of Mahabharata. That's the beauty of what we are about to begin for the next 18 weeks. Arjuna himself is not in the perfect position. Our protagonist, Arjuna, is ridden by ego. Because if you're not ridden by ego, you're going to see things objectively. He's not. So that's where we are. Let's see what Arjuna says. So, just a condensed few slokas of what Arjuna tells Krishna. Verse 21, he tells Krishna, Krishna, place my chariot between, I've omitted a few slokas, just put in a few, it's okay. Place my chariot between the two armies, O Krishna, that I may see these standing desirous to fight. With whom all I must fight in this outbreaking battle. So in slokas 21, 22, Arjuna's state of mind is pretty intact. It's not that he was put in this fight that morning. They've been planning for months. They've gone through the details. But at a distance, everybody can be objective, both by time and space, meaning 2 months before this, everybody can be objective. It's at the moment of truth that we lose objectivity. So Arjuna knows what he has signed up for. He understands cognitively in his role as a Kshatriya, having no other options left. This is what he needs to do. So when he asks Krishna to ride him into the field between the two armies, he says a very logical thing as a Kshatriya. He says, take me there because I want to see who the enemies are, whom all I should fight in this battle. And Krishna takes him there to the middle ground between the two armies. 26, 27. There Arjuna saw standing fathers and grandfathers, teachers, maternal uncles, brothers, sons, grandsons, and comrades, fathers-in-law, and friends of both the armies. Fast forward, Arjuna says, Krishna, my bow slips from my hand, and my skin burns all over. My mind whirls as if it were, and I am not able to stand. Then he says things that all signal the right things, but coming not from virtue, but coming from escapism. He says, when I see these people on the other side, I desire not victory, kingdom, or pleasures. What avail is this kingdom to us, O Krishna? If the enemies armed with weapons should slay me unarmed and unresisting in battle, that would be better than me. That would be better for me. Having spoken thus in the battlefield, Arjuna sat down in the chariot, the seat of the chariot, casting away his bow and arrow, with mind distressed with sorrow, telling Krishna that he will not fight. Now, the thing is, the psychology here is that at the face value, he's probably taken a wise decision, isn't it? Like when you see what he saw, it's not easy, sir. Take the example of modern day armies itself, our own India's army or any country's army. On paper, it's like two countries go to war, but at the moment of truth, you recognize the human being there. You recognize that guy is also has his family, parents, children. But even today, people go to war, isn't it? What is the right thing to do? We don't know. We can judge and say everybody should love each other, make love, not war, and all those slogans. But to keep a society in order, what is right? We don't know. there is this beautiful poem which says that if I had met you elsewhere in a coffee shop, we might have spoken about Shakespeare, and we might have spoken about our girlfriends, and we might have spoken about 100 things. But here I meet you in battle. You on that side, me on this side, and we must kill each other. I'm distorting the poem, but it's very beautiful. I read it in CBSE textbook when I was in school. This author says that if I had met you elsewhere as a comrade, we might have had coffee, we might have discussed women, and we might have discussed literature, we might have talked Shakespeare, we might have been in a band together, we might have been brothers. But here we are meeting in the battlefield, me protecting my side, you protecting your side, and you and I must kill each other for that. What a sad state of affairs. But as long as there is human folly, the world needs to be having some order as well. That is the conflict of dharma, which is swadharma versus sadharana dharma, which is your true self versus the duty in the role that you're performing. King Janaka, for example, great king, self-realized king. Does he like bloodshed? No. He is an elevated soul, a spiritual soul. But in his role as a king, which is to protect the millions of people under him, if an enemy advances and murders his people, rapes the woman in his place, as a king, what does he do? The duty of the king takes over with the stability of his spiritual knowledge inside. That is the top left quadrant. Swadharma and Sadharana Dharma can exist together. That's the top left quadrant. On the righteous side, for impersonal reasons. On the righteous side, for impersonal reasons. I'm not going to kill anybody, but I also have a sovereign duty to protect people. What is the midpoint? We don't know, but in there lies, that's why dharma is subtle. Therefore, on appearance, it seems Arjuna is saying all the right things, isn't it? He says, when I see my grandfather, my uncles there, I don't want to fight. Arjuna, let them win this battle. Whose battle is it for him to decide who should win or not? It's the emotions having overridden him. Months of planning is useless in the moment of truth. He is telling Krishna that I'm giving it up, as if it's his battle to give up. One, he's physically incapacitated because his mind has taken over. Two, number three, his intellect hasn't been strongly built. Therefore, it doesn't rescue him at moment of need. So he tells Krishna, let them take everything. I don't want anything, but it's not about him. It's not about him. That's what he fails to grasp in chapter one. I feel bad, therefore I don't want to do things. It is not about you. It's about what needs to be done, when it needs to be done, whether you like it or not. A Janaka also doesn't like to see blood, but it's not about him. What does a king need to do? Do it and shut up. What is gold standard action, sir? My duty starts with action, ends with action. Anything outside of that, I'm not going to be a judge, jury, and executioner of. And the way I define action is not what Aditya needs to do. What should a person do in this situation? Because life is about bad versus bad, sir. We can't escape and be in a cocoon called spirituality and be indifferent and escape the world. We are in the world. And meaning we have to do things sometimes that is not ideal. The question to ask is, in my job, not what Aditya likes to do. What should a good consultant do in this situation? What should a good father do in this situation? Not what I want to do in this situation. A good father needs to at times discipline the children, needs to love the children, needs to create good citizens in the future. At the same time, understand they are here of their own desire, own devices and karma. What do I want to do in the situation? I want my children to be like this. I want them to study well. I want them. What should a father do in the situation? What should a son do in the situation? What should a citizen do in the situation? Objectivity. So the problem with Arjuna is not in the face value, because everybody asks this question about Gita, saying Arjuna, what he said is the perfect thing to say. Isn't dropping the weapons, make love, not war, isn't that better? Sir, it is better momentarily. But the reason why this war came up is because of years and years of disharmony and greater miseries that lie ahead unless a decision is reached. And the decision was reached after 14 rounds of other kinds of settlements, diplomacy, negotiations. But at the moment of need, it's difficult to stand up. So that's the doership. So if you look at this, there are many reasons for... Get the right side. There are many reasons for Arjuna's despondency. One is the exaggerated doership. It's about me. I don't want to fight, so this battle should not happen. Two, focus on the result and this being in the way. Sir, he also wants to win. So what if he wasn't on the battlefield? Then is he okay for others killing his relatives? That's hypocrisy, isn't it? He wants to win, but this should not be the way he should win. So he's going through all these emotions. Focus on the result. Sorry, mind emotions taking over at the moment of need. Intellect isn't strong. So what we're going to end with today's class is this graph about body, mind, intellect. See, this is the philosophical landing point of today. We all have a fully expressed part of us, which is the gross body, the physical body. But we are also driven by the subtle body, which is not physical. So don't search for that inside your brain. That's a useless way to see it, because the brain itself is gross body. We exist in different form of subtlety, sir. The fully expressed part of us is the physical body. The non-physical aspect of us is the subtle body. And there is a hierarchy that needs to be established for smooth working of ourselves. Some people may be very body-centric. It's the physicality that becomes most important. In ourselves, we ourselves are, isn't it? We keep looking at the mirror and admiring ourselves. So we're body-centric people. But most people, as they grow up, children may be very body-centric, but most people, as they grow up, become mind-centric. So mind is what your temperament is, what your thoughts and emotions are. This is where vice and virtue is. This is where your envy and greed is. This is where your emotions are. So helplessly, whatever is the concoction or whatever is the reinforcement of their mind, you are driven by those emotions. And therefore, you're called an emotional person. Now, if you look at this hierarchy, what is up has the overriding power of what is below. So your state of mind has an overriding power on the state of your body. Therefore, when Duryodhana's mind is a certain way, it has an impact on the body. when Arjuna's mind gets emotional, it has an impact on his body. His hand is quivering. He can't hold his own bow and arrow. He is the world's best archer. He sits down. His knees are weak. He can do 400 squats otherwise, but he's sitting down. His knees are weak in a moment. How can your knees become weak in a moment, sir? You have probably 8% fat content, great muscle mass, but your knees can't hold you because your mind can override your body. Now, if there is no greater overriding power above the mind, it is mind that is calling the shots. It's the inmates ruling the asylum. Therefore, the inner world of our mind is in a disastrous state. That is stress. That is anxiety. That is depression. That is these chronic problems. There is a part of the subtle body, which is the other side of the coin of the mind, called the buddhi, the intellect. The intellect doesn't come pre-existing. It needs to be built with knowledge, with reflection, with objectivity, with mentorship, with analyzing, with text teacher tuition. It's the gross intellect. Intellect means buddhi. It is the power to impersonally discern and distinguish. It is the power to keep the mind in check, not by control, but through reflection, being able to discern and distinguish and call the bluff of our own mind. The reason the mind is a problem, sir, is because it is not objective, meaning what you feel at this moment is not what you're going to feel 10 minutes from now. So how can you trust your mind? 2 hours ago, Arjuna was saying, this is the right thing to do. I'm in. Now he's saying, I'm out. 1 hour later, he's going to say, I'm in. Fourth hour, he may say, I'm out. How can you trust? Today, when your anger is in the peak, you're a monster. Tomorrow, you're the sweetest person. Day after, you're a monster. Today, you want to quit your job because you feel shortchanged. Tomorrow, you love your job. The mind is fickle, sir. It's ephemeral. Therefore, the mind cannot be given the keys to your life and peace of mind because you're giving it to the inmates, and inmates controlling the asylum is not a good, not a good recipe. You need a greater overriding power that can keep the mind at check. That is called intellect. Mind is just a series of reinforcements, meaning you reinforce envy, that becomes front and center in your mind. You reinforce goodness, it becomes front and center in your mind. The intellect doesn't come inbuilt. The intellect is the power that you establish in yourself, the strength that you establish in yourself by guiding yourself to the right resources, teaching yourself the power to discern and distinguish. And that intellect is called buddhi. We'll end with this today. So there is a gross body and subtle body. Each step here overrides, has the power to control the faculty below. Of course, keeping your body sound and fit can keep your mind clean. But the body doesn't have an overriding power to your mind, which means if the mind decides to become envious, whatever health your body is in, it's your mind that will control your health. The intellect, once established, has an overriding power on the mind, which is once you have an objective intellect, I will do what needs to be done when it needs to be done. It's not about me. I'm just a player. I'm not the judge, jury, executioner of the world. I can see things clearly. Then it has an overriding power, even on envy, even on greed. And over time, they dissipate, distinguish, and you've established neutrality. You've established objectivity. So the ending of today is, currently what's happening with Arjuna is that it's become topsy-turvy. If you see here on the slide, the top, the intellect is incapacitated, meaning it's not been strengthened enough to come to his own service at the point of need. Therefore, the mind takes over, and whatever the reinforcement has been, that becomes the mind, and there is suboptimal performance at the body level, even though he's a warrior. When you reestablish order, when you build intellect, your intellect gives you the right perspective and proportion, keeping your mind in good cheer because at check, therefore the physical body is dynamic and healthy. So in chapter 1 of the Bhagavad Gita, we have seen the two armies assemble, Arjuna asking Krishna to take him to the middle of the battleground. He falls on his knees, surrendering to his mind and adamant that he is not going to fight the battle. Next week, we will look at chapter 2, enormous chapter, but we are giving only 1 week per chapter, where Arjuna continues and our hero, the divine soul, Krishna, commences his address to Arjuna, which is captured in 17 chapters called the Bhagavad Gita. Thank you, everybody. Be connected on chat, and I'll see you all tomorrow. Thank you. Sorry, next week. Thank you.
Thank you, Aditya.
Thank you, Aditya.
Thank you, Aditya.
Thank you, Aditya.